What's going on, everyone? Mr. Lee here, and this is the first part of the population and migration unit where we will discuss population distribution, delve into the demographic transition model, and discuss natalist policies. First off, let's talk about the various factors that contribute to population distribution, starting with the physical factors. Climate and temperatures, landform and terrain, and bodies of water will determine where populations will be concentrated at. Regions with inhabitable conditions and temperatures will have lower population densities. Take, for example, the Amazon forest, where you will see high levels of humidity and high temperatures. Therefore, there's quite a bit of remote indigenous populations within the Amazon. Landforms and terrain also play a huge role in determining population distribution, as you will see that places with high elevations, such as Mount Everest, and places with low elevations, such as Death Valley, will have low populations as well. Lastly, bodies of water will impact population concentration significantly. If you were to map out the top 5 populated cities around the world, what pattern might you notice? You'll note that they are all near bodies of water, with the exception of modern-day Mexico City, although at one point there used to be a gigantic lake that used to exist there, an enormous city called Tenochtitlan, which was known as the floating city until the Spanish conquistadors and Hernan Cortes came through and ravaged the entire empire with smallpox, but that's besides the point. Human factors can also affect population distribution, such as culture. This can be seen in Jerusalem, as it is home to many religious sites, thus it will increase the population density. Economics can also affect population distribution, as job opportunities will increase population densities like regions such as the Sun Belt. And lastly, politics and government can also affect the population distribution, as seen with the Homestead Act, which was a government program that incentivized people to move to the Wild Wild West by giving them free land. They used to give out 160 acres to people, which is the same as 80 soccer fields. It's like the Oprah show, but instead of cars, they're giving out free land.
1, 2, 3.
Then there's the concept of population density, and we'll have to do a little bit of math here.
2 + 2 = 4 - 1, that's 3, quick maths.
There are 3 ways to measure this distribution or density, first of which is arithmetic density, which takes the total number of people divided by the total number of land. Arithmetic means math, so when you're doing math, you're usually trying to find the total, so think total of everything. The second measurement is physiological density, which divides the total number of people divided by arable land, which just means farmable land. A silly way to remember this is to look at the first 2 letters. P equals people, PH, farmable land. Lastly, there's agricultural density, which is easy because agriculture needs farmers, and you're taking the number of farmers divided by farmable land. Each one of these will give you information on the carrying capacity of various countries and how much pressure they exert on the land. Carrying capacity is the maximum number of people that a piece of land can support. For example, Singapore has only about 2 acres of farmable land, but has a population of 5.6 million, which means that technically they should exert quite a bit of pressure on their land, which is actually not the case since they import about 90% of their food. Population distribution can also affect political, economic, and social processes, as higher concentrations will generally lead to higher funding and services from the government, such as medical care. Another really good example of this could be your schools, as school districts generally tend to get funding based on the number of students present at school. Densely populated regions will also attract more businesses and affect economic processes. Take a look at this population density map of the United States and the distribution of Walmarts across the US. You'll notice that there's a direct correlation between regions with larger populations and the number of Walmarts in those regions. Then let's move on to population compositions and the demographic statistics such as age and sex. The best way of providing a visual representation of this data would be through population pyramids. Population pyramids have 2 sides, the males on the left and the females on the right, and each bar represents increments of 5 years. Different scales of analysis will affect population pyramids. For example, take a look at the distribution of gender in the United States. But if we change the scale and looked at a city like Unalaska, we'll see that they have a large male population, primarily due to the dangerous fishing that you might have seen in The Deadliest Catch, and also because of the military base that is there. Let's now look at Sarasota, Florida, which was deemed the best retirement city in the United States. You'll notice that there's a greater number of older people in the city due to the number of people retiring there. Compare that to Lawrence, Kansas, a college town, and you'll note a significantly larger population in the 18 to 24 range because of the University of Kansas. Before we delve any further into population pyramids, let's go ahead and cover some basic terms that you must be familiar with. Crude birth rate is a number of births per 1,000 people. Crude death rate is a number of deaths per 1,000 people. Natural increase rate is CBR minus CDR, essentially the rate in which your population is growing. Infant mortality rate is the number of babies dying under the age of 1, and child mortality rate is the number of babies dying between the ages 2 and 5. Life expectancy is the average age one is expected to live in a country, and total fertility rate is the average number of children a woman will have through her childbearing years. Then in reference to population growth, geographers use population doubling time to describe how fast a population is growing. Essentially, it is the number of years it takes for the population to double. And to calculate this, you divide 72 by the annual growth rate. Say, for example, there was a country that had a population growth of 2%. Then to see how long it would take to double its population, you would divide 72 by 2, and it would take this country 36 years to double its population. With population pyramids, there are three basic forms: expansive, stationary, and constrictive. Expansive population pyramids look like a cone, and it means that there's quite a bit of children being born, thus a high fertility rate and CBR. However, you should notice that as the children get older, the bars progressively get smaller, which means that there's a significant number of children dying, thus a high CDR. This can be due to a lack of healthcare, famine, or diseases, and will lead to low life expectancy numbers and extremely high CMRs and IMRs. Then there's stationary, which looks like a box with a small cone up top. In this population pyramid, the bars look stagnant as they progress through the years, which means that they have good healthcare and can prevent diseases. Thus, they are able to maintain a stable population. They have long life expectancies, as shown by the bar's horizontal height, and have low CMRs and IMRs. Lastly, there's the contracting population pyramid, which looks like a ghost. It is a top-heavy population pyramid with a significant number of older people up top, but not as many people being born. These population pyramids have low TFR, CBR, and NIRs because people are refusing to have babies for several reasons: expensive rent, high cost of living, and because people are pursuing their careers instead of having babies. These population pyramids directly translate to the demographic transition model, a model that takes you on a journey through a country's population statistics as the country develops. There are five different stages to this model, and it breaks down like so. Stage one of the DTM has a high birth rate, but it is counteracted by a high death rate, and a lot of people are being born, but at the same time, quite a bit of people are dying because they don't have good healthcare and hospitals. Thus, the natural increase rate is almost non-existent and the population stays low. Technically speaking, there are no countries in the stage one of the DTM, rather small remote groups around the world, such as indigenous groups. Then, as the countries move into the second stage, their death rate starts to decrease. This is due to increased healthcare, education, and infrastructure. At this point, they are able to prevent some infectious diseases like malaria, hepatitis, and tuberculosis with modern medicine and hospitals, thus less people are dying. Birth rates tend to stay high in these countries, and women tend to have more traditional roles, so they have more children during their childbearing years, and they will have a high TFR. Since birth rates are high and death rates are decreasing, the natural increase rate, the blue section, will get larger, thus the population will grow. Countries like Niger are perfect examples of the stage. Then in the third stage, as a country progresses, the death rate will continue to decrease as the healthcare progresses, and eventually birth rates will start to decrease along with it. One of the reasons why birth rates will decrease is because women will start becoming more educated and go to college and pursue their careers during their 20s, so they will not have many children. Also, with the development, the cost of living will also increase, so it won't be as feasible to have as many children as before, and families will generally tend to have less kids. Natural increase rates will still tend to be high in these countries, as the gap between CBR and CDR is relatively large, so the population will still be growing in stage 3 countries. Mexico is a really good example of a stage 3 country. As we move on to the fourth stage, the CBR and CDR will start evening out, thus the population growth and NIR will level out as well. The death rates are extremely low because infectious diseases can be prevented. However, there will be a significant number of people with chronic diseases such as cancer and heart disease. This is because their life expectancies are around 60 and 65, and at these ages, you'll start seeing more chronic diseases. This concept of different diseases surfacing at different stages of development is known as the epidemiological transition model. It states that earlier stages will see infectious diseases and later stages will see chronic diseases. Infectious diseases are preventable and can be treated with medicine in hospitals, whereas chronic diseases are not, as it includes cancer and heart disease, both diseases that you will see later on in a person's life. As mentioned before, the women in stage 4 countries will be career driven and will delay childbearing until after their careers are established, so the birth rates will be low. Also, contraception will be commonly utilized in stage 4 countries, so it will also contribute to the low CBRs. The United States is a really good example of a stage 4 country. And finally, there's a fifth stage, and this stage is still hypothetical, but demographers say that populations will decrease in this stage, such as the population of Japan and South Korea, and the cost of living will be so expensive to the point where it's not fiscally reasonable to have more than one child. In order to maintain a population, a country must have a TFR of 2.1. And when a country like Japan has a TFR of 1.36, their population will start decreasing. A contracting population pyramid like Japan will run into several problems in the future. Eventually, the older generation will enter retirement ages and the younger, smaller generation will have to support their retirement, and this can lead to financial troubles for the entire country. Governments can implement different policies to counteract such drastic population changes, such as pronatalist and antinatalist population policies. An easy way to remember the difference is to remember the root word natal, which means birth. You might have heard of prenatal vitamins, which are vitamins that women take before giving birth. So a pronatalist policy is a policy that is pro-birth and a policy that encourages birth. Earlier, we talked about countries like Japan and South Korea who are struggling with low birth rates, and thus they would want to implement a pronatalist policy by giving tax credits to people who are having more children, provide better child leave benefits, and might even want to utilize pronatal propaganda. Here's a quick visual that demonstrates the various methods that countries are utilizing in order to deal with shrinking populations. Its counterpart will be antinatalist policies, and these policies will discourage birth. The biggest example of this was evident in China during the 1980s as their population was growing at an alarming rate. If families were having more than one child, they would have to pay significant taxes on the second child, and it even led to families aborting daughters, as China was a patriarchal society and families preferred having boys. This led to an uneven distribution of sexes in China, and now there are too many men in China compared to the number of women, and men are having a tough time finding dates and people to marry. Not only were tax policies utilized to prevent birth, but propaganda is often used as well, as seen by these Chinese posters. In India, population growth was getting so bad that the government even hosted sterilization camps where they sterilized a staggering 6.2 million men in just 1 year. All right, that does it for the first part of the population migration unit. Make sure to check out the Quizlet link down below to brush up on your vocabulary.